Hi, welcome to the video on Pinot Segment Assignment. My name is Neha Pawar and I'll be your host for this video where we'll learn how segment assignment works in Apache Pinot, mainly focusing on offline tables. We will look at all the actions that happen behind the scenes from the time a Pinot segment is uploaded right until it's ready to serve queries. Here's a quick summary of what to expect in this video. We'll do a brief architecture overview of Apache Pinot and talk about all the components that play a role in segment assignment. Then we'll discuss some concepts which influence segment assignment, such as tenants, tags, and replication. Finally, we'll walk through all the steps that happen when a segment is pushed to a Pinot cluster. Before we begin, here's a brief introduction on Apache Pinot. Pinot is a real-time, distributed OLAP data store that can provide ultra-low latency analytics even at high throughput. Originally built at LinkedIn, Pinot can power a variety of analytical applications such as dashboarding, anomaly detection, as well as user-facing real-time applications. Pinot is used in many companies such as Uber, Microsoft Teams, Weibo, Slack, and many more. Let's look at a quick recap of Pinot's architecture. A Pinot cluster is composed of brokers, servers, which can be of two types, offline or real-time, and controllers. The brokers accept queries from clients, forward them to the servers, receive results back from the servers, and then merge and send the results back to the clients. The servers host data and answer queries received from the broker. So how does this data get into the servers? Data in Pinot is stored as segments. Each segment is data packed in a columnar fashion along with dictionaries and indexes. These segments are stored in a segment store. In case of real-time servers, the servers are directly consuming from a data stream such as Apache Kafka. That data is periodically converted to segments by the real-time servers and then pushed into the segment store. In case of offline servers, things work slightly differently. The raw files are converted to Pinot segments offline by ingestion jobs, which are then pushed to the segment store. The controller is notified of the segment, and then the controller instructs servers to download segments from the segment store. The controller manages all the components of the cluster with the help of Apache Helix, and Apache Zookeeper is used as the metadata store. If you'd like to know more about the architecture, the components, or any concepts, here's a few resources that will help. You can head over to pinot.apache.org and find our documentation and lots of getting started resources. Now let's dive into some concepts which play an important role in the segment assignment in Pinot, such as tenants, server tags, and replication. Coming back to our Pinot cluster, let's take an example of a more practical Pinot setup. Say we have two brokers and four servers. Say we created a Pinot table in this cluster called Foo Offline with a replication of two. Then we took the data that we want to push into Foo and say we created three Pinot segments. These segments, when pushed to the Pinot controller, will get distributed amongst all these available servers. We'll have two copies per segment because that's what our replication factor is. Now, if we create another table in the same cluster, say bar_offline, and again we created say three segments, these three segments will also get spread across all the four servers. When we get queries for either Foo or Bar, both the brokers will be able to accept them and the queries will be forwarded to all the servers. What if we wanted to achieve isolation between these two tables? Would we have to create separate clusters for every new use case that needs isolation? No, we can accomplish that with the help of tenants. In Pinot, each node can be given a tag. A tenant is a logical component defined as a group of server or broker nodes with the same tag. In our setup, I can tag server 1 and server 2 and the broker 1 with the tag tenant A, and that creates this tenant called Tenant A. Similarly, I can tag server 3 and server 4 and the broker B2 as Tenant B, and that creates the tenant called Tenant B. The next step is to pass this knowledge of tenants to the table config. In the table config, we can set server and broker tenant names, which then helps us define the exact servers and brokers that this table should use. So for the table foo, if we set the broker as tenant A and the server as tenant A, and in the bar table, if we set broker as tenant B and server as tenant B, now any segments of the foo table will only occupy servers of tenant A, and the segments of bar table will only occupy the servers with tenant B. Same for brokers, a query for the foo table will only be answered by a broker in tenant A, and for the bar table will only be answered by the broker in tenant B. A Pinot table can also use separate broker and server tenants. For example, we could divide this as 3 servers in tenant A, 1 server in tenant B, and 2 brokers in tenant shared. Now our tables will share the broker nodes but will achieve isolation at the server level, and each tenant can be scaled independent of the other. So far, we have seen the components of a Pinot cluster, a basic data ingestion flow, and how we can use tenants and tags to define the servers that will participate in the segment assignment of a table. Now let's see how segment assignment actually happens in offline tables. Let's go back to our cluster. This time, say we have 3 servers which have been tagged as tenant A. We create a table foo with replication 2 and server tenant to use as tenant A. This table config gets stored into Zookeeper. Let's also bring the controller and the segment store back into the picture. Now let's get the data we want to push to this table, for which we run our ingestion job and generate 1 segment. The ingestion job will push this segment into the deep store. It will also notify the controller about the new segment. When the controller receives the new segment metadata, it will gather a series of information from Zookeeper. Firstly, it will ask for the table config. Using the table config, the controller will identify the server tag for this segment. The controller will then fetch the list of servers which belong to this tenant. In our case, that's server 1, server 2, and server 3. Lastly, the controller will also fetch the current mapping of any previous segments that were already assigned to this table. Using this list of servers and the current mapping, the controller will find the number of segments that each server is already responsible for. Using that information, an ordered list of servers will be created. Finally, the controller will pick N servers which have the least number of segments, where N is the replication factor. As of now, there's no segments on any servers, so let's say that the controller picks server 1 and server 2. The controller will then update the mapping in Zookeeper with a new entry for the incoming segment. So in our case, this will be segment 1 with the mapping server 1 and server 2. This mapping is called the ideal state. Helix is listening to changes in this ideal state. And when it sees the new entry for segment 1, it will send a state transition to the servers 1 and 2. The servers will then download the segment from the segment store. Once the segment has been downloaded, Helix will update another mapping called the external view. This is similar to the ideal state. The ideal state represents what the state of the cluster should be, whereas the external view represents the actual state of the cluster. And Helix is in charge of performing actions or state transitions to make the external view in sync with the ideal state. Finally, when the external view has been updated, the segment is now ready to serve queries. The same set of steps happens every time a segment is pushed to the cluster. The controller first gets notified of the segment, the controller comes up with a segment assignment based on the current state and the tagged servers, and then the controller updates the ideal state. And then Helix takes care of the rest. for segment 2. Server 3 is the least loaded server, so it will definitely get picked, along with one of server 1 and server 2. To summarize, we saw all the steps that happen when a segment is pushed to the cluster until the segment is loaded and ready to serve queries on the servers. We also saw how tenants, tags, and replication affects the servers that will be used for a segment assignment. That's it from us on this video. We welcome you to leave your questions, comments, and feedback in the comments section below. Do watch this space for more videos on segment assignment coming soon. We will talk about how segment assignment works in real-time tables and more details about a segment's lifecycle, including operations like rebalance, retention and aging, storage tiers, advanced segment assignment strategies, query routing, and much more exciting stuff. So don't forget to subscribe. We also welcome you to join our Slack channel and get connected with the fast-growing Apache Pinot community. We're also on Twitter @ApachePinot and would love to get connected with you. Thanks.